If you're a serious British artist in the 1930s, you're now faced with a difficult decision. Do you fight for Britishness like Spencer, Munnings and Coldstream, or do you throw in your lot with the foreign avant-gardes and go modern? It's a tough decision. British, modern. If you choose the former, you risk being irrelevant. If you choose the latter, you risk being despised. And many artists faltered at this point. But there was one who decided to do something no one else even thought of doing. He would try to reconcile the two, to make British art modern and modern art British. It was a masterstroke. And his name? Paul Nash. Paul Nash had made his name as one of the most powerful painters of the First World War. But his sympathies with surrealist ideas went back much further. He was born into an affluent, middle-class home, but his was not a happy childhood. He was a weak, a nervous boy, bullied at school during the days and tormented by terrifying dreams at night. His mother was a manic depressive who was prone to fits of violent rage. Paul created a secret world for himself where he could hide from all those things that upset him. This is Nash's hiding place, and it's right at the end of his garden. The house is over there. And being here today, you can see exactly what captured his imagination about this place. The whole thing is like a kind of magical kingdom. Down there, for instance, that's a tree stump, but at the same time it looks like a gnarled fist. And this is where Nash developed this extraordinary idea, the idea that nature was alive, that it had a personality, and that he had a kind of intimate relationship with it. Nash's favourite part of the garden was this row of trees, which then marked the perimeter of the family's property. He was transfixed by them. He had this lovely idea that they were like a row of women hurrying into the distance wearing these fantastic hats. And you realise with ideas like that, Nash was, for want of a better word, a surrealist. But he was a surrealist years before the term was even invented. It was Paul's childhood communion with nature that inspired him to take to the road in search of a uniquely English style of surrealism. Paul Nash was like no other motor tourist. He wasn't interested in the picturesque villages and quaint pubs and sandy beaches that everyone else was looking for. Instead, he was drawn to the dark, strange, and uncanny corners of the English countryside. On his journeys around England, Nash painted a singular set of landscapes. A pile of logs by the road in East Sussex. And a haunting array of objects on a Dorset clifftop. But the climax of his journey was in the ancient landscape of Wiltshire. Paul Nash first discovered this part of the country in the summer of 1933, in quite extraordinary circumstances. He was actually out on a day trip when he suffered a severe asthma attack in a bus. His other passengers genuinely feared that he was dying, and he was being rushed to a nearby hospital when suddenly he glimpsed something through the window. And as soon as he saw it, he made a miraculous recovery. What Paul had seen was a great field filled with standing stones. And that was just the beginning of a remarkable relationship.
when he came here, I don't think his mind was in a good shape because he was searching for a direction in his work. And when he came here, he found a way of connecting his interest in surrealism with his love of landscape. The thing that I find interesting is that it's full of history. You're aware of the whole of man's history in this island since the beginning, really. And you can see it all around you, or you're aware of it, you get a sense of it.
Paul Nash had an overactive imagination. So where most people, like me, see this as, well, an old stone, he saw it as a 4,500-year-old person making his way slowly but quietly across a field. It's an extraordinary idea, and one that I think only a child, a madman, or a visionary artist could have been lucky enough to have had.
He's always been a sort of a hero to us, really. And painters don't lose their impact. They're still as powerful because he just took the feelings he had when he was there and made them into a painting. And that's the best way to do it. And the way he used the paint was so powerful as well. He didn't fuss it around. He just put it on with power. And that power comes through.
Nash painted the stones at Avebury again and again. But his masterpiece shows them as a set of modern, manufactured structures that have somehow crash-landed in a cornfield. It's inexplicably haunting, as much a landscape of Paul's mind as it is of the Wiltshire Plains. I think Paul Nash had a revelation here, and I think that revelation was this. You didn't have to go to Paris to find surrealism. You didn't have to read Sigmund Freud. You didn't have to go to bohemian restaurants and cafes. All you had to do was get out into the English countryside, and you could find our own native surrealism everywhere you looked. Because after all, what's more surreal than the chance encounter of a modern artist and an ancient boulder in an English field?